once I'm done with the welcome, I'm going to say, now let us take a moment to greet our neighbors.
Yeah.
You'll do this part?
Yeah.
Okay. So once we do that, I'll head back and you'll take care of that. Totally fine. I mean, I'd like to do that just because it says something about one of your last services. And
anyway, if you can figure out a way to
we'll work it out. But right here, go back to my seat.
Yeah.
Great. And then I'm going to grab the book on my way back.
Yep. We meet on holy ground, brought into being as life encounters life, as personal histories merge into the communal story, as we take on the pride and pain of our companions, as separate selves become community. How desperate is our need for one another, our silent beckoning to our neighbors, our invitations to share life and death together, our welcome into the lives of those we meet, and their welcome into our own. May our souls capture this treasured time. May our spirits celebrate our meeting in this time and in this space, for we meet on holy ground. Come and let us worship together. I invite you now to rise in body or in spirit and join in singing our opening hymn, Morning Has Come. It's number 1000 in your teal hymnal. And of course, the words are also on the screen.
Morning has come, arise and greet the day. Dance with joy and sing. Song of gladness, a light of hope here shines upon each face. May it bring faith to guide our journey home. A new day dawns, once more the gift is given. Wonder fills this moment shared to. Open our eyes to see that life abounds. Open hearts to welcome it among us. The light of love here shines upon each face. May it bring faith to guide our journey home.
Invite you to remain risen as we light our chalice this morning, the symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith.
We light this flame to honor the history and individuality that each of us brings to our community. As Bell Hooks writes, beloved community is formed not by the eradication of difference, but by its affirmation, by each of us claiming the identities and legacies that shape who we are and how we live in the world. May you embody a wholehearted compassion and loving kindness for the immaculate being you are. Good morning. No problem. I just got cataract surgery, so I'm trying to figure out, do I need these, don't I? But they're all new bionic eyes. Good morning and welcome to Emerson Unitarian Universalist Church and happy Pride Month. My name is Tess Lotta. My pronouns are she, her. I am very grateful to be serving as your worship associate today for my first time. Thank you to all my comrades for their support. I extend a warm welcome to all of you here today in person, as well as the good folks joining us online. I invite you to take a moment to turn those cell phones off, and we thank you for your consideration in wearing a mask. If you are new today to Emerson, we are happy that you are here. Our church is named after the 19th century American Transcendentalist poet, Ralph Waldo Emerson. Emerson Unitarian Universalist Church has provided an inclusive congregation in the West San Fernando Valley since 1954, aspiring to create together a loving, equitable space for which to hold and support anyone seeking spiritual, personal enrichment. We lift up the people, the first people, of the ancestral and unceded territory of the affiliated tribes of the Tongva, Tatavium, Serrano, and Chumash that is now occupied by our church. We honor their elders and descendants, past, present, and future generations, by educating ourselves about the citizens that descend from the originative native peoples of this occupied land, as well as support their tribal repatriation and land back efforts. I highly recommend the current exhibit, Native Resistance in the California Missions and Beyond, currently at the Autry Museum of the American West in Griffith Park. We welcome you to sign our guest book in the foyer or our virtual guest book linked from the chat for those of us joining on Zoom. We offer many opportunities to be part of the Emerson community. For more information, you may sign up for our weekly e-blast newsletter and other Emerson programming announcements, as well as follow our social media hubs on Facebook and Instagram. In a moment, I will invite you to greet your neighbors. During that time, please feel welcome to write in the physical book of life over there at the memorial table, as well as the virtual book of life, and share any joy or concern, an occasion or thought you'd like read aloud with the congregation during the service. For those of you on Zoom, you will find a link to the virtual book of life. After our service today, we will hold our congregational meeting. However, before that, we welcome you to join us for coffee, nibbles, and conversation in our pavilion or in our virtual coffee hour on Zoom. Let's remember, today we welcome new members of the congregation. We celebrate the closing of a current book of life and an opening of a new one. We honor today as one of a handful of remaining services for which we are fortunate to have Reverend Matthew, Anna, and River at the heart of our beloved community. Now, let's take a moment to greet our neighbors in the spirit of welcome and worship.
Sorry.
Let's see. Which?
Do you ever write the, any stuff for the service?
So I should probably do. I make arrangements, but I don't. It was that. This did a little. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah. Yeah. So that.
Love that part.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, there's stuff. I should probably write some stuff. I've thought about it. Okay.
All right. Nice.
Nice. Yeah. Nice. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, they do. Okay.
I know.
You raise me up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's right. That is funny. Yeah. She's oh, thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, you know, we used to have people singing every single week, and we kind of got away after during COVID. We sort of kind of got away from a lot of that sort of stuff. So. Okay. Oh, nice. Yeah. That's right. I wish we did. But, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, I'm not sure. I honestly don't know what the budget is.
We'll find out today.
All right. Oh, thanks. I'm so glad. Thanks. Hey, how you doing? How are you? Good. I'm so glad. Yeah, it's going okay. This new treatment's kind of kicking my butt, but yeah, it does. This last one was a weird thing. It caused my hands to swell. You can see it's still a little swollen. It caused my neck and my hands and arms to as if I had gotten sunburned. There was a sunburn that never went away, and my hands blistered and peeled, and it was awful. In addition to the fatigue and all that sort of stuff, yeah, it was just an awful thing. And then my shoulder started hurting, it started really getting really bad. And I'm thinking, well, maybe it's just a flare up. It's kind of immunotherapy. Maybe it's just a flare-up of my arthritis, because I have psoriatic arthritis. And it's just, so they did an MRI. The nurse said, the NP, the nurse practitioner said, we better do an MRI just to make sure. Sure enough, I have a tumor in my shoulder. So that's kind of, it's like good and bad mixed kind of thing. At least I'm healthy, I can work and stuff. It is. But at least I can work and I can do stuff, so. Kicks my butt a little bit. Yep.
It is good to be together. So today is a special day in the life of our congregation. We are being transformed. With our new member Sunday, these folks who are joining our congregation are going to bring new ideas, new desires, new energies, and new opportunities to us. And we are going to share our ideas, our desires, our energies, and projects with them. Our covenant securely grounds us. Our covenant securely grounds us, but it also resonates with new life. As the Reverend George Kimmich Beach put it, people don't join a covenanted community. Rather, they constitute it. There is no it without them, and each time new folks join, the whole is literally reconstituted. And so, to remind ourselves of our center, let's join in saying our covenant words together, first in English and then in Spanish. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest for truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve humanity in fellowship, thus do we covenant. La doctrina de esta iglesia es el amor. La búsqueda de la verdad es su sacramento y el servicio es su oración. Vivir juntos en paz, buscar el conocimiento en libertad, servir a la unidad en comunión, este es nuestro pacto.
Hi, I'm Amy Noel. I'm your board secretary, and I'm on the membership committee. And so part of that, it is my joy to celebrate our congregation, this special day, our new members. So, as your name is called, will you please come to the front? Tess, Lotta, Dave, Glashinsky, Martha, Sharp, Dan, Sharp. Wonderful. Clover Kustak? Clover Kustak, who grew up at Emerson, joins us now as an adult. And Ramon Sanchez are also new members, but they weren't able to be here today, so we will honor them at a later service. We encourage you to share with us your creative thoughts, your vital experiences in life, your doubts, and your dreams about what life and our lives together can be.
Why don't you come up? Why don't you come up here on the chancel? Come on up. Yeah, So this is kind of a participatory piece, and you do have some parts to say, but thankfully they're very easy, and I will prompt you. And there's also some parts for the congregation as well that will be on our screens. So it is a joy to welcome each of you today. Becoming a member of this congregation is an important step, but it's only a first step. So I encourage you to grow your religious life and to explore and share your unique gifts. Will you journey with us together with us, sharing the joys and responsibilities of membership? If you agree, please say yes.
Yes.
I think that was all right.
This is a day of celebration for all of us as we honor your commitment to become members of Emerson Unitarian Universalist Church. We know that you did not come to this decision lightly. I ask the members of our congregation, will you reach out to these people in friendship, including them in your activities and fellowship? Will you travel with them on their religious journey? Will you be open to their unique gifts and perspectives? Will you extend a warm welcome to each of them, remembering that each one of you was once a new member?
As you journey alongside us, I ask that you share with us your creative thoughts, your questions, your doubts, and the values which you hold most dear. I invite you to shake us up with your honest thinking, to stir us with your conscience, and to stimulate our hopes with your dreams. Ours is a shared ministry, to help each other find meaning in life and to build a more just and compassionate world. And now, as a symbol of our joining together, earlier I invited our new members to write on one of these strips of fabric their name and a hope or a dream they have for this church. And now I'm going to invite them to weave that strand of fabric into this loom that we have. This is a practice we started several years ago. And so in here are also other strands of fabric that people have written on, shared their names and hopes and dreams and woven them as kind of a symbol of how we weave community together, creating out of our individual strands a beautiful tapestry. It's easier to put it down. And of course, we do have to, part of this, I love metaphorically and physically. You know, sometimes we need to make a little space for people. And so find places for people to weave in. Oh, you already wove it, great.
Now invite our new members to accept a gift, a hand-painted chalice, and a copy of the Unitarian Universalist Pocket Guide, and we offer you the hand of fellowship.
So can you get to pick out, we have six chalices here, so you can pick which one you'd like to take with you. If both, you know, if you only want one book for yourself, that's also fine. If you want two, if you're both so excited, you want to read them together. And so now, as our children go off to their religious education class this morning, I invite you to join me in saying our Unitarian Universalist affirmation. You can join me in the hand motions if you know them, and even if you don't know them, they're not very hard to pick up. You're welcome to join. We are Unitarian Universalists, a people of open minds, loving hearts, and welcoming hands.
As part of our commitment to live out our Unitarian Universalist value of generosity, we share the plate with a local organization doing good work in our community. This month, we are sharing the plate with the West Valley Food Pantry. Emerson is a founding member of the coalition that formed the West Valley Food Pantry in 1985. As the needs of the community have grown dramatically in the last few years, with the pantry serving around 10,000 people who are food insecure, including people who are experiencing homelessness, families, and elderly people living on a fixed income, providing them not just with food, but also the basic necessities and support services. Donations can be made using the Breeze app or at donate.emersonuuc.org and by selecting Sunday offering. If you're writing, if you're paying by check or donating by check, please make checks payable to Emerson UU Church and write "Share the Plate" in the memo. If you would like to make a payment on a pledge, please write "Pledge" in the memo. We now gratefully accept your offerings.
From you I receive, to you I give, together we share, and from this we live.
Today is also a special day in another way in our congregation. For the past 7+ years, people have written joys, sorrows, concerns, and milestones in our book of life. This book has been a vessel for our individual and collective experiences, capturing moments of celebration and of hardship, and forming a chronicle, a sort of chronicle of the life of the church. Now this book is full, and this morning we close it symbolically by honoring all that is contained within. And so I've invited our pastoral care team, Heather Medvitz, Melissa Marote, and Pam Randall, to help read anonymized excerpts from this book. Joys, sorrows, milestones, and those that defy easy categorization and may blend them together. And as I think over what has happened in those past 7+ years, I'm reminded too that in this time, two of our past pastoral care associates, Gail Silva and Pat Lindenauer, passed away, and another, Karen Rose, moved away out of state. Much of what you will hear is specific and personal, but in the specificity, we are reminded of universal human experiences. Many birthdays were celebrated, 18th birthdays, 60th birthdays, 7th and 75th birthdays, 22nd birthdays, 1st birthdays, and a 100th birthday, as well as birthdays that would have been. The most common entry was about cancer. Some were successfully treated and in remission. Some are no longer with us, and others are still receiving treatment. In addition to personal sharing, there are mentions of suffering in the wider world and invitations to rally against gun violence, protests for the environment, and marches for interfaith solidarity. And in the middle of all of it, a 20-month gap from March 2020 to November 2021, when our book of life became virtual. And as we reflect on all that is contained within, which I also note overlaps almost completely with my ministry, starting less than 6 months into my ministry and closing just a few weeks before it ends, it in some ways is a chronicle of my time with you. And so as we reflect on all that is contained within, let us hold in our hearts the stories and emotions that weave the fabric of our shared journey.
These are some of the joys recorded in the Book of Life. These occasions of happiness and celebration remind us of the beauty and blessings that fill our lives.
My dad's MRI is clear, so thankful.
We are so grateful for the gift of 8 years of life after receiving a donation of stem cells.
Thank you to everyone who's been beyond welcoming since I moved to the area. Your warmth and kindness mean so much.
I now have 2 cataract-free eyes.
Charges were dropped for my niece who was arrested in a Black Lives Matter protest. She learned her activism at a UU church.
She is a week out of her hip replacement surgery and is doing well.
Dear Mommy, happy birthday, written in a child's handwriting.
We are grateful for all of you. Thanks for the cards, calls, and texts. It has been a difficult couple of weeks for our family, but your kindness and support helped us get through.
I had a good visit with my bio family, even though it was to take my brother's ashes to sea.
Grateful for the blooming California native plants in our garden.
My academic paper on Chicana poet Gloria Anzaldúa has been accepted for publication.
Grateful to reconnect with my daughter after a few years.
I honor my father and mother who gave me the gift of music and art.
It is with deep gratitude that we take our leave from this beloved church and the deep and lasting friendships we have developed over 18 years.
After 20 years, I finally have my own apartment.
My first Father's Day away from my father, I will happily be singing for him today.
So grateful for the nourishing rain behind us and the outpouring of light that is to come.
We celebrate our 35th wedding anniversary tomorrow.
Gratitude for the inaugural celebration of Indigenous Peoples Day in Los Angeles tomorrow. It is long overdue.
Let us take a moment of silence to reflect in these joys and give thanks for the positive experiences in our community.
Sorrow and concern are also shared in this book. These entries remind us of the pain and challenges we face and the importance of supporting one another through those times.
Today is 3 years since my mom passed away. She was my best friend and I miss her every day.
I put my beloved cat to sleep. He slept with me every night and sat by my side every day. He spent his last day in the backyard lying down and enjoying nature. He will always be in my heart.
Finally got sick with COVID. Glad it wasn't worse.
Prayers for my friend's teenage daughter who died in a car accident.
Thoughts and prayers of loved one had an MRI this week. We are all praying for good news.
Sorrow for families and unaccompanied minors in detention centers and asylum seekers being turned away from the U.S.-Mexico border.
My mother's cancer has returned, this weight heavy on my heart as we prepare to fight again.
Rest in peace to my mother-in-law who died yesterday due to complications of the coronavirus. Light and hope to the many children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren left behind.
Sorrow for the communities in the forest that are impacted by these horrific fires. My heart aches for climate justice.
I give thanks for the 20 short years my cousin blessed her parents with in her challenging but glorious life. She died of a drug overdose this week. Please hold the parents of all the dead children in your hearts and thoughts.
Much sorrow for my family this week with the loss of my sister to cancer last week and my mother last evening.
Remember that microaggressions hurt.
My son's beloved service dog was put to sleep peacefully this week, surrounded by all who loved him.
Prayers for my friend who has been moved to hospice.
I request light, strength, support, and protection as now the unknown approaches.
Let us take a moment of silence to hold these sorrows in our hearts and offer our compassion and understanding to all those grieving.
Our Book of Life contains significant milestones, moments of change and transition that mark our journeys of our lives.
Congratulations to all our middle school and high school graduates.
Today is my and my twins' 63rd birthday. I am grateful.
Good luck as our son starts his junior year of high school.
Remembering two pillars of the church who passed away on the same day last year.
Today would have been our 36th anniversary.
I am celebrating 18 years of sobriety.
6 months of sobriety.
It's my fifth day of not smoking.
Celebrating 25 years of living in LA. It has truly been life-changing. Mostly for the better.
Last week, I celebrated my 50th college reunion.
It was 4 years ago that I was diagnosed with cancer. I cannot adequately express my deep gratitude for this wonderful community and the support and outpouring of love who have shown me and my family. I am truly grateful beyond words.
Let us honor these milestones and honor the journeys of each member of our community with a moment of silence.
Let us now take one final moment of silence to honor all that remains unwritten but is inscribed on our hearts. Our Book of Life is filled with the rich tapestry of our experiences. So as we ritually close this book, binding it with ribbon and white sage and another sage flower from our garden, we close this chapter in our church's life. And we conclude this ritual by opening a new book of life and sharing what is written in it this week. Eric Schmidt writes, Emersonians, please support our newly formed outreach team and join us in the Pride March in Van Nuys on June 29th, Saturday, June 29th at 11 a.m. Todd Covert writes, my sister let me know last night that she is in the process of choosing a date to end her four-year battle with cancer. She will be with us only a few more weeks. May I have the strength to support her and her partner, however she needs me to. And Martha Zetterbaum writes, Jules, my spouse and partner of 58 years, passed June 4th after a long battle with Alzheimer's. I'll just note, some of you may know Jules and Martha. They are honorary lifetime members of the congregation, although they have not been around as much recently, but this church has been a very meaningful part of their relationship together. I check our virtual book of life as well. From Jim Wallace. Bill Anders, the Apollo 8 astronaut who took what I consider to be possibly the most beautiful photo ever taken, Earthrise, passed away this week. I always viewed that image with awe. Today, I found out that it inspired the founders of Earth Day and gave a huge boost to the fledgling environmental movement. Thank you, Bill, for changing the world's perspective. And Nicole writes, a joy that her eldest and their partner are visiting her mother, their grandmother, while she has hospice at home. Their presence is bringing healing to the family there. I lift up two that yesterday at least 274 Palestinians were killed and 698 wounded in Israeli strikes on the Nusrat refugee camp in central Gaza. May we continue to pray for peace, to work for peace, compassion, and understanding in what ways we can, as we hold in our hearts all of those who are impacted by violence and war there and around the world. In a moment, I'm going to sound this singing bowl, and after I do, I invite you to speak into this space or type into the chat any joys or sorrows, any names or milestones that are on your heart this morning and that you would like lifted up into this community in this, our embracing meditation. May we continue to support one another by celebrating joys, comforting sorrows, and honoring milestones. Let us move forward with love and compassion, ready to write new chapters in the story of our community. I invite you now to join me in singing our sung meditation, All This Joy. This is a call and response song.
Within the postmodern pagan traditions in which I have framed my spiritual practice over the past 30 years, I identify as a solitary, eclectic, Wiccan, Buddhist, spiritual humanist. Double dare you to say that 10 times really fast. While it might not make for a good vanity license plate, this showy string of signifiers expresses my spiritual language as steeped in mystery traditions centered on seasonal rites of nature. And while not associated with a specific pagan group, my practices are drawn from many sources, of which Buddhist and spiritual humanists are foundational. My hybridized spiritual identifier came together during my coursework for a master's degree in English, influenced by theorists such as those of Black intersectional feminist bell hooks and 20th century Russian linguist and philosopher McHale Bakhtin. Mr. Bakhtin presents the idea that when we think of language, we misguidedly think of it as something as fixed. That fixed dialectical identity, he says, causes troubles like war. He urges us to think of language as something we experience. He wants us to understand the experience of language is developed from what influences us as separate and distinct human beings. And importantly, because we keep on experiencing, our language is constantly in flux. So, we are informed by a conglomeration of culture, social and familial norms, history, displacement, privilege, marginalization, and resistance, and etc. When we come together as a community, these multiple languages, as Mr. Bakhtin refers to these influences, intertwine to create a shared language. In the crucible of our community exchange, it's a language that is ever evolving as we learn to relate to each other. As I anticipate the new UU shared values proposed by the revisions of Article 2, I envision a scene. And it is 1951. Mr. Bakhtin is sitting at his well-worn desk as the department chair of Russian and World Literature at Mordovian University. He is contemplating the shared values flower image, and suddenly, the crease of his brow gives way to a rare smile as it surfaces through a full mustache and beard. "Bravo," he exclaims in a thick Russian accent. "This, my friends, is a fine example of what the heck I've been spouting about since 1918. Why did Mr. Bakhtin travel through time to give UUs the high five? By putting love at the center of the reframing of our seven principles, we are free to further expand outward, being changed, taught, evolved by the multiplicity of influences, the social cultural differences, the voices that challenge who we are as you use from culture to politics, denominations, orientations, identifiers, diaspora to revolution, human experiences. The shared values affirmation that surround love at the center suggests these complexities. We are called to recognize, for a lot of us, admit that one experience does most certainly not fit all, as bell hooks proved when pushing back on white feminism. And importantly, the circular motion proposed by the shared values flower image reminds us that our shared language is a living language, that as we translate our shifting collective experiences into communal space, we recognize and cherish our shared humanity. In that way, as Emerson congregants and you use, we are creating a purposeful relational space that not only has its own ever-evolving language, but is also one voice in the larger shared language of Unitarian Universalism. And I value that. I mean, I don't go around announcing my long-winded spiritual identity at parties as a conversation starter. Hey, solitary, eclectic, Wiccan Buddhist, spiritual humanist in the house, want a party? But I can express that identity here, freely in this relational community, this other space in which our shared language offers a compass by which to relate to each other as loving beings. So if the mighty bell hooks can identify spiritually as a Buddhist Christian, I challenge anyone to snort a displeasing scoff at my long-winded spiritual identifier. And thanks to Mr. Bakhtin, I gleefully relish stacking my spiritual hybridized identifier to reflect more closely with my spiritual place, one deeply shaped by the influences of all my experiences and study, and importantly, those folks with which I practice it with. Hello, I'm Tess, a solitary, eclectic, Wiccan, Buddhist, spiritual humanist now exploring Unitarian Universalism with my comrades here at Emerson. please rise in body and spirit to sing the song Swimming to the Other Side. As the congregation, we're gonna sing the chorus parts, and the chorus parts are, we are living neath the Great Big Dipper. So those are our parts. Thank you.
And if you wanna listen this first time, feel free to listen. If you wanna listen this first time, you feel free to listen. If you know it, you can sing it with us.
We are living beneath the Great Big Dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power and some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. I am alone and I am searching, hungering for answers in my time. I am balanced on the brink of wisdom. I'm impatient to receive a sign. I move forward with my fences open. Imperfection, it be my crime. In humility, I will listen. We're all swimming to the other side. We are living in the Great Big Dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power and some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. When we get there, we'll discover all the gifts we've been given to share have been with us since life's beginning, and we never noticed they were there.
We can balance at the brink of wisdom, never recognizing that we've arrived. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. We are living beneath the great Big Dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power and some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming on the other side. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side.
Now, maybe I shouldn't even draw attention to the clock. I knew this service might run long, and I felt it was important with our new member Sunday and this once in a many year occasion of honoring the Book of Life that if things need to take longer, that is okay. Sometimes church does not follow, worship does not follow the clock. And since this is my second to last sermon, I am only going to cut my sermon very shortly. It's not very long anyway, so don't worry too much. But I'm grateful to have grown up in a UU church. I'm grateful for the values I learned in religious education, which called me to work for a more just and equitable world and to care for the planet. I'm grateful for the opportunity to be able to ask questions and seek out my own answers. I'm grateful for the comprehensive sexual education program that was better than anything that I received in public school, and that when, as a teen, I was trying to figure out my own sexual orientation, I knew that my congregation, which marched in the Pride Parade, would love and support me however I identified. And woven throughout all of those things is perhaps what I am most grateful for: the connections I made with other kids my age, but also with teachers and other adults more than four times my age. Knowing that I had a community of people who loved and supported me and looked out for me. And frankly, I'm sad that more people didn't have a chance to experience that sort of multi-generational community that meant so much to me. And that the number of people who do continues to shrink. Things have changed. In the 1950s, up until the 1980s or 90s, you went to church. Almost everybody went to church, or perhaps a temple or synagogue. If you were an atheist or an agnostic or a seeker or someone who bristled at orthodoxy or creeds, or you were in a multi-religious family, then you went to the Unitarian Universalist Church. But most people attended somewhere. Some of you remember that time. Perhaps that's when you first started attending this church. But nowadays, if you're a socially liberal, educated person under, let's say, 55, you know, especially if you're an atheist or an agnostic, you sleep in, you go for a hike, you go out to brunch, or take your kid to their soccer game. But you probably don't go to church. Now, I understand it. People my own age have seen the Christian church grow ever more closely associated with the political right, fighting against reproductive justice, declaring LGBTQ folks sinful, using religion to justify wars in Muslim-majority countries. Not all, mind you. I want to be very clear about that. There are plenty of socially progressive congregations out there. People called by their faith to work for justice, but they don't get as much attention. And so, more than 25% of young people who stopped attending church did so because their church no longer reflected their values. And many people left because of the harms they experienced in their congregations.
But a lot of people moved away because of cultural changes. Now, some of you who are not young, and you know, around 55, I use that term generously. The Reverend Matthew Johnson says, "You may not understand how absolutely countercultural it is for a liberal, educated person to go to church in today's America." Most of my peers don't go to church, even those who grew up attending church. And when I tell someone who's my age or younger that I'm a minister, in the back of my mind, I'm wondering, oh my God, what are they thinking about me? I'm not that kind of minister. These days, singing hymns is weird. Making financial pledges, serving on committees, going to congregational board meeting or congregational meetings, who does that? Today, 28% of Americans identify as non-religious, making them the single largest faith group in the country. And when it comes to religious institutions, those changes are even more dramatic. 2019 was the last year that a majority of Americans belonged to a religious institution. Now, only 40% attend once a month or more. Those same respondents said that growing up, 70% of them attended once a month or more. And over the past several years, I've read numerous articles and think pieces about the decline of religiosity in America and what it means for our society. Now, I personally don't worry about what it means for American morals because I don't believe we actually need religion to be moral people. Although being in community and orienting ourselves towards something larger than ourselves can help instill those values and encourage us to think beyond our own narrow self-interest. But I think all of us have also seen people use their religion to justify their intolerance. So the articles that jumped out at me were the ones by folks who grew up in a church but left after they became atheists or agnostics, or who had grown up unchurched and never cared that much about the decline in religion, but recently have come to worry about that decline, even though they don't attend church. Paul Thornton wrote in the LA Times about an experience of losing his mother, and even as an atheist, how appreciative he was about the support from his mother's Lutheran pastor in the grieving process. But he also knew that he didn't get that same level of support his family had received when his grandfather had died tragically when he was a child. He writes, "It was as if someone had put up the grief bat signal, and a posse of humble Lutheran superheroes sprang into action. We were surrounded by people who didn't have to be told what we were going through. They just knew and tried to make our lives a little easier, offering to bring us dinner and help care for my brother and me, comforting scratches on the back of my neck by a few of the old ladies in the pews, rare moments of tenderness from people who would normally scowl at kids like me for being fidgety during church." And he goes on to wonder what that meant for his children who didn't have that same experience growing up. "Non-religious parenting comes with trade-offs," he writes. "My kids never had to worry as I did about displeasing God or the eternal fates of their non-believing loved ones. But in this life, right here and now, they're grieving as I did when I was their age, but without the support built into faith communities. And so are countless others experiencing age-old traumas outside the local institutions that once helped guide them. For me, losing those people has been more profound than losing God." Now, when I read that, I was thinking, hey, you should come check out the Unitarian Universalist Church. It has the best of both worlds, where you can get community and the support without the dogma. Now, the thing is, This decline, though, is not unique to churches. Back in 2000, Robert Putnam wrote the book Bowling Alone about how participation in social organizations had been declining for years, even back then in 2000. It's only increased since. Clubs, bowling leagues to book clubs, churches, dinner parties, all of them, participation in all of them are down. And the thing that Putnam wrote about is that these are the places that we learn about, and build a sense of mutual obligation, responsibility towards one another. It's the places where we come together often to work for the common good. Now, we can do spirituality alone. I think a lot of people do. That's, I think, what some people mean when they say spiritual but not religious, is this idea that, yeah, I'm just gonna go be a spiritual person on my own. And I understand what they mean. I also know that some people go, well, Unitarian Universalism isn't really a religion in that sense. But in another sense, it is. It's that coming together as a group of people. And so, you know, if you can do it alone, but if we do it alone, whether that's a meditation practice or something more in depth, we're missing out on something. The activity may still be going on, but there's no social capital being built. There's no connections being made. And loneliness, what is Putnam suggests, is a threat not only to our health, which it is, but also to the health of our society. Organizations and connections between people are the ways that big changes happen. Like community organizing, which is a systemic approach to addressing the root causes of social problems. You know, it's a process where people work and act together to make a difference in their community. And it's through community organizing that people meet others who share similar values and interests and identify common goals and learn skills for working with public officials to create solutions to problems that affect their families and their neighborhoods. And so many of us are focused on the presidential election and on national politics. I know I'm paying close attention to the Supreme Court cases and was paying close attention to criminal trials in New York. And they matter, but I can't make a difference there. It's the local where I can make a difference, where we can make a difference. And so that is where we need to act from. There's a new documentary out about Robert Putnam and the book Bowling Alone and his work. It's called Join or Die, a movie about why you should join a club, which I should note, you can only watch by organizing a screening in your own community, which of course is beautiful. The director of that documentary says, the movements we celebrate, abolition, civil rights, suffrage, gay rights, even the American independence movement itself, were constituted of various associations, clubs, unions, congregations, leagues, assemblies, congresses, and conventions where ordinary Americans met routinely. She continues, we also talk about how clubs are the places where people learn civic skills. It's associations where we practice how to run a meeting, to give a speech, to plan an event, to organize a protest, to resolve tensions, recruit collaborators, spread ideas, build bridges, and gather and wield power. And so we need these places where we can build connection and community. You may have heard of them referred to as third places. A place other than home, the first place, and work, third places. And so these third places are where communities gather. They can be barber shops or beauty salons, churches, clubs, coffee shops or bars, libraries, malls, parks, study places at college, senior centers. One of mine is the community theater down in Long Beach after the show ends. And you may have your own that are special to you. And I happen to think that a church is one of the best of them. I think we can see that reflected in some way just in that ritual of honoring that book of life, of how our congregations can show up to support one another and celebrate with one another and to organize one another to work for a better world. I would say don't be spiritual but not religious. Be spiritual and religious. Religious in the sense of being part of a community, joining together. You can explore those big questions on your own, but it's a richer experience in a multi-religious community to shift from an I perspective to a we perspective. Because as humans, we've always been a we. That's how we survive, by recognizing our interdependence with one another and with the earth. And as I said, I don't think there's another institution that is as well suited to supporting folks when times get hard as a Unitarian Universalist Church. And the church, as I mentioned earlier, a covenantal church is its people. This is just a building that we're gathered in right now, or maybe on cameras, on Zoom, but the people inside it joining on screens, y'all are the church. And so as I prepare to leave, I invite you, I know so many of you are so dear to me, and I know I am dear to many of you, and some of you are wondering who the next minister will be. And I invite you not to think about that too much, because the minister is important to a degree, but it's all of you, all of us, that make up the church together. So show up, and show up regularly. And I'm not saying this to nag or to guilt trip you. I'm saying this, it is because through showing up regularly that we deepen our connections to the church and to the members of this community. And without this, one misses out on the depth of experiences here. You are the church. It's not this building, hallowed though it may be. And so I invite you to commit to this institution, which has existed before us, before we joined it, and to commit to it, to commit to its strength and its health, and so that those who have not stepped through these doors, those who have not yet even been born, may be able to come through its doors one day in the future and find what I and so many others have found, a beautiful, beloved community. May it be so. I now invite you to rise in body or in spirit and join in singing our closing hymn, whose name is not on the thing, and I lean on me, there we go. Please rise in body or in spirit. The words are on the screen. They're in your hymnal, but we're doing a different arrangement, so don't follow along there.
Three. Somebody to lean on. Please swallow your pride. If I have things you need to borrow, for no one can fill those of your needs that you won't let show. You just call on me, brother, when you need a hand.
We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you'd understand. We all need somebody to lean on. Lean on me.
when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on.
That was, we cut it off early. All right, we cut it off early. I guess the service was running long, so. Well, that works. Oh, and there's the title. I wonder, oh yeah, we got it all twice. As our service comes to a close, I want to offer a brief moment of gratitude for all of those who help make this, who help make this service possible. For Tess, our first, doing her first time as a worship associate, also being welcomed as a new member. Gratitude to our new members, both here and those who couldn't be here today. Thanks to Kevin and Adam with the music, to Conrad and Phil up in the crow's nest, or Conrad and David up in the crow's nest, the folks at the welcome desk, the people who have helped set up for who've set up for our coffee hour, the folks who don't know it yet but will help clean up for coffee hour, those of you who will be staying for the congregational meeting and doing the work of the church today. You all, as I said before, are the life of this church, and your contributions are so important. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And now, as our service comes to a close, I invite you to reach out and take a hand, or bump elbows, or touch a shoulder, make some connection if you, as you feel comfortable, with someone nearby you. To those of you joining us on Zoom, we invite you to reach out and send your energy to us as we send it back to you and to the other folks on Zoom. Let us bless and keep one another. Let kindness rule in our hearts and compassion in our lives until we meet again. Amen, ashe, and blessed be.
Amen.
One, two, three, four.
Nice.